Hello, everyone, and happy Earth Day. We are super excited to be celebrating Earth Day here on our live stream today. And we've got a fun one planned for you. You do not want to miss a single minute of it. And in fact, Camera Guy is out in the field today bringing us something special just for Earth Day. What a great view. We've got to celebrate our Earth. We've only got one big, beautiful Earth. So it's up to us to take care of it. How you doing out there in the field, Camera Guy?
Doing great. Beautiful day out here for a hike, especially on what's today called?
Earth Day.
I'm going blank. On Earth Day. When we are having our pre-production meeting about this live stream, I said, Kim, I got to go hiking while we're doing this. And let's take the technology out into the field. So we're out into the countryside here where Kim and I often hike. And just last week, we had a rattlesnake encounter on this trail. So
we did.
I'm kind of looking all over the place here, you know, making sure everything's good, but it's gorgeous out.
Don't step off the trail. If you hear those rattles, we totally understand if you run. Yep. Okay. We get that. And I'm sure our viewers here are going to understand too. So glad that you all are here to celebrate with us.
Yes. Everyone, thank you all for being here.
Absolutely. And Jerry's going to be safe. And we just want to greet you all here. Ray Nickel is here from Seattle, unusually cold up there. And hopefully cool. Things warm up a little bit. We've actually had a little bit of chilly weather too. Camera Guy, the skies are blue. It just cleared up just in time for you to be out there on a beautiful, beautiful hike. We had a pretty overcast morning this morning.
Great. Let me show you all a pan shot of what I'm hiking through. Talk amongst yourself.
Beautiful. All the gorgeous wildflowers are going to be crazy amazing this year because of all the rain we've had. In fact, those look like mustard seed flowers. I'm sure a lot of you have planted mustard in your garden. I can't see real clearly, but the hills surrounding our city and around California are covered in wild mustard that blooms in the spring when it rains. And it's absolutely gorgeous going out for a hike. Little wild daisies, I believe those are.
Yep.
And tons of wildflowers this year. So hiking right now is amazing if you can handle the potential snake encounters.
Yep.
So let's say hello to those of you that are here. We do have some special guests here with us today. Of course, Cliff and Nisha, our faithful moderators here.
Yay.
Every single week. And Smart Pots Container Garden experts are here. Jerry Webb, snakes, nope. Yeah, hopefully not. Charlene Mitchell, it looks like a Brill Trail. Not sure what that is. Maybe that's a Spain thing. So maybe you can explain that to us. The Mangarino Adventures, awesome, but scary about the snake.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy. We were just hiking along. We actually had Mac with us. And Jerry turned around to get a photo or a video or something and all of a sudden heard that unmistakable rattlesnake rattle. So we hightailed it out of there. And I don't think we'll be taking Mac up on that trail anytime soon. So there's lots of tall grasses there this year too.
Yep, I should have known better. And there's nothing like that sound of a rattlesnake. Once you hear it, you don't forget it. And you recognize it immediately when you do. But the Earth is a beautiful place, and we definitely have to take care of it. And that's exciting that all around everyone is doing that, focusing on that today. And when you're out here hiking like this, it just reminds you of how important that responsibility is that we have to recognize that and take care of the Earth.
Absolutely. So I encourage you to take the time to get outdoors, not only in your garden, but go around your local area. I'm sure there's lots of beautiful hiking trails or lakes, depending on where you live, that you can visit. Terry said, listen to the birds. And yeah, the birds this year have been incredible too. I don't know, Jerry, you may even see a few hawks flying by behind you.
Yes.
Because we frequently see them up there when we go hiking.
Yep.
Michelle, exactly. Is Camera Guy lost?
No, not. I know exactly where I am. And actually, I'm going to be taking the trail right behind me here. And I'm going to show you some other really cool views from there with a special, but kind of a special famous spot. And we'll see if some of you are aware of that. So we'll be taking you there throughout the live stream.
Can't wait to see it.
So I'm good. Don't anybody worry about me. I'm okay. I have water. All right.
He's got water. He's got snacks. He packed all kinds of stuff that he needs for the time that he's up there.
I have my hair product. I've got my blow dryer.
Yeah, always be prepared. We actually, after we had the snake encounter, I got a snake venom extractor kit on Amazon. And we pack that in our hiking backpack now, just in case we want to be prepared if us or Mac ever got bit. So hopefully that doesn't happen, but we're prepared just in case. But we are going to jump.
Oh, go ahead, Jerry. Really quick, Kim, I want to just special shout out to Dana. Dana works with us in Cali, Kim, and he's at the control panel today running this whole show. And Dana, thanks a lot. You're doing great.
All that. Yes. So it is a team effort here today. And we are going to jump into our Peppers Do It Right. And Jerry's going to be hiking up the trail and we'll be checking back in with him in just a little bit. So camera guy,
thank you.
Thanks
okay.
for starting out with us on the hike. And we'll see you in just a few moments.
Yep. You got it.
Okay, so it's all about peppers today, and peppers, besides tomatoes, are probably one of my very favorite things to grow, and you want to do it right. So I'm going to be sharing with you some tips to grow tons of peppers in your garden so you can do it right too and really enjoy those beautiful, gorgeous peppers. Now, before we jump into the tips, I just want to share a few pepper basics, just so we lay the groundwork, and that way you can really start things off good. Now, with our pepper basics here, they are a warm weather vegetable, and maybe a lot of you already knew that, but if you're brand new to gardening, you might not have any idea that that's what they are. But they grow best at temperatures between, I say, really thrive in 70 to 90, 95 degrees. And here you can see one of my harvest baskets of peppers from last summer. They come in so many beautiful different colors, shapes, and sizes. So I really encourage you to grow the rainbow. Hot peppers, sweet peppers, small peppers, big peppers, lots and lots of different kinds. And I think they probably have just colors and shapes galore. Then that's one reason why they are one of my very, very favorite things to grow. And the cool thing about them is you can start them from seed indoors, or you can start from transplants. If you're running a little bit late in the season, you might want to grab a few transplants at the garden center. But either way, you're going to be able to grow yourself lots of beautiful peppers. I think starting from seed, to me, has more advantages because there's so many different varieties that you can choose to grow from seed, a lot more than would be available as transplants at the garden center. And generally speaking, they take about 60 to 90 days to go from transplant to harvest. Whoops, my notes almost blew away. So, you know, you usually do want to get them started as early as possible, about 8 to 10 weeks before your last frost date. I think most of us are around that time or past that time now. So if you're past that time, get seed started right now. Even in southern climates, I'm still starting new pepper seeds. So that way I have a continuous new wave of peppers in case some of mine die or get eaten up. I always like to have backup plants that I can plant a little bit later in the season. They work great in containers. We just did a video a few weeks ago on growing them in a 5-gallon container, which I've got actually right here. And I'll be covering a little bit more on that in just a moment, but the smart pots work great for that. And 2 to 3 plants in a 5-gallon container, or even 3 to 4 plants in a larger container there. And do make sure you check out our recent pepper video, like I mentioned, called Peppers, the Biggest and Best Ever. So make sure you check that out on our YouTube channel. So I don't know if camera guy, he looks like he still might be hiking a little bit. So we're going to talk a little bit more about peppers before we jump into our very first surprise of the live stream. So pop if you have any pepper questions in the chat, and we're going to start off with something fun on our live stream. I think actually I'll go back into pepper tip number one while he gets to a brand new location. Now, pepper tip number one is we talked about starting peppers from seed. And a lot of you who are pepper experts and pepper veterans, maybe I should say, know this very, very important tip, is when you start peppers from seed, you need to start them on a heat mat. Believe me, it is well worth the investment. They like that little bit of bottom heat. And here you can see, I think these are my Orange King pepper seeds from the Pizza Garden box this month. And by the way, today is the last day that you can grab one of our Pizza Garden boxes over on our website. And then we're switching over to the May box. But these are the Orange King peppers on a heat mat. And what that does is, because peppers do like it nice and warm, they're warm weather loving vegetables, the heat mat just raises the bottom of the the bot raises the heat just a little bit underneath them to where it really helps boost and speed along their germination. And I highly recommend that as soon as you plant those seeds in your little six pack, that you pop them on a heat mat right away. They like to get off to a nice warm start, and you'll be amazed at how that really helps them pop through the soil a whole lot quicker. Sweet peppers generally take about 7 to 10 days to germinate, and the heat definitely helps them. Hot peppers, though, be patient. If you've been frustrated about hot peppers not germinating, they can take 2 to 3 weeks, sometimes even a month. So they definitely do take much longer than the sweet peppers. How warm does it need to be to put it outside? Bob from Missouri. We're going to cover that in our next tip here. So hang on to that question. Julie, great question here is, do you turn the heat mats off after germination? What I like to do is, you can see that my peppers there on the heat mat where maybe, well, you can't really see how tall they are. Actually, they're right here. I brought them outside to show you guys. They are maybe about an inch or two tall. And I actually still have them on the heat mat because we've had, our weather has been up and down. It's been cold, it's been hot. And what I found is when it's cold and I take them off the heat mat and my house is maybe around 65, not quite 70 degrees, they just kind of stall out. So really the growing, ideal growing environment for them should be around 70 to 75 degrees. So, you know, when the weather gets warmer and it's around 80, 85 and your house heats up, once they germinate, you can actually take them off the heat mat and they'll do just fine. But if you're wondering why they kind of stall out, if you take them off the heat mat, it's probably because where they're growing is just too cold for them. So really do keep an eye on the temperature of where you have them growing. That being said, I actually have these growing in my grow light closet. Now, when the weather heats up, it gets very, very warm in there when I have the heat mats on all the time. You don't want them growing or from seed, a little seedling anyway, where it's over 90 degrees. So just kind of monitor that. And if they get too hot, they're also going to stall out. They're not going to do too well, especially as little seedlings. So do keep an eye on your seed growing area and then monitor and make adjustments as you go. I mean, that's what it's all about, right? It's just experimenting and kind of getting to know your growing situation and then adapting what you've learned here and what you've learned through your own experience to whatever is going on. Okay, so we're going to take some questions in just a moment, but camera guy, are you in a place where we could do our first fun surprise? Oh man, yeah. He is huffing and puffing.
You can.
And I know where he's hiking, the first uphill, we call it a booty buster because he had to go fast too. It is a real booty buster. Camera guy, it's beautiful back there. Great job getting to the top.
Yep. Thank you.
Okay. We'll let you catch your breath. We are going to do something very special for Earth Day. We're giving away a couple of Earth Day packages. All right.
Sweet.
So this is going to be fun. We've got three different things in our Earth Day package. Here we go, guys. First thing is the Smart Pots 15-gallon black with handles. So This is an amazing container. One of my favorite sizes. The handles make it easy to move around. This particular container on the screen here, you can see a tomato plant in the back and then an oregano plant, but it's plenty large enough for, I'd say, 3, maybe 4 pepper plants. So a great, great container. And we also have something that a lot of you have been asking about because the bugs are kind of bad this year. So we are also giving away one of Monterey's products. They're one of our brand partners, as is Smart Pots. And this is one of my favorites so far. It is the Takedown Garden Spray. This thing's amazing. It will take down just about any pests that you have in your garden. So many different pests are listed on the back label, from aphids to whiteflies to fungus gnats to beetles. You can use it indoors, outdoors, up to day of harvest. You can spray preventatively. It's a dormant spray as well as an active bug spray, and it will kill bugs at all stages of development, the larva, the eggs, the full grown insects. So it is really a great one. It's organic. So this is it, part of our package, as well as, of course, one of my pepper seed collections. So the hashtag for this is Earth Day. So if you can pop in Earth Day in the chat, we are going to draw for our Earth Day celebration giveaway. And while you're doing that, I just want to share with you one way that we were able to really celebrate Earth Day is we were actually hired by a local or fairly local elementary school here in Southern California to do a special Earth Day celebration for the students. So super excited about that. 375 students today are watching a special Earth Day video that we prepared for them. And they're planting, Smart Pots jumped in on it. They're planting a little classroom garden in a 20-gallon Smart Pot. So each classroom is going to have their very own garden, as well as a special little Earth Day goodie bag that we prepared for each student to take home. So we were very honored and honored that Smart Pots jumped in with us. And there's 375 students today that are learning how to plant their classroom gardens and their own gardens at home. So we're very excited to be able to help with the kids learn where food comes from and celebrate Earth Day in the process. So we've got 44 people here in the chat that have popped in. Camera guy?
I wanted to say that it was a really fun video to shoot because it just was different. But in this video, Kim would instruct the teachers and then say, stop, do the action we just talked about, then come back here and continue. It was just different. You know, we'd never done that before. So anyway, it was just really fun. It had a whole different feel.
Really fun. And we just feel good today. I said to Jerry when we got up, there's 375 kids today that are learning how to plant a garden and learning where food comes from. So super excited to be a part of that along with Smart Pots to send
Let's
the
go.
Kids on their way today. All right, 53 entries here for our package.
Good
birthday
luck, everyone.
Giveaway package. So we have 54. So we're going to go ahead and choose our winner in 3, 2, and 1. So Dana, go ahead and draw the winner here.
Now I feel like Vanna.
There you go. All right. Who's going to win? And this is for U.S. residents only. I think I forgot to mention that. Nisha. Oh my gosh. I'm so excited.
Yay,
that is awesome, Nisha.
Nisha.
Nisha's a wonderful gardener and our moderator from Colorado. And you're going to love this, Nisha. So we'll get this sent out to you. Thank you so much for all that you do to help us out. And I know you're going to enjoy using that in your garden as well. So congratulations.
Nisha too, by the way, a very, very good gardener.
Go ahead, Jerry. Sorry about that.
Nisha is a very good gardener. She knows what she's doing out there.
She sure does. And in fact, Nisha sent us a picture over the weekend. I think, Nisha, what'd you get, like 6 inches of snow or something crazy like that in Denver? But Denver, I grew up in Denver, so Denver has these cold, heavy, wet storms every single April, and then it melts. I think it's 75 or 80 probably there today. So, Nisha, I'm sure you're warming up and hopefully be able to get out in your garden real, real soon. 5 inches of snow. Craziness. Okay, guys, let's head into the chat for a little bit and see what questions you have about peppers before we move on to point number 2, okay? And don't go away because we have some other really fun things planned for the remainder of the live stream. You don't want to miss a single minute of it.
And so I'm going to move on down, Kim, I'm going to move on down the trail and I'll keep my camera on. So Dana, if you need some filler footage or something, you want to put my camera POV on, you're more than welcome to do that. That way people can see the trail and that kind of thing. But I'm going to head on down.
Stay hydrated, Jerry.
Oh, I have been.
And I think that's mustard flowers behind him there. So if you're growing mustard in your garden, leave it into flower because the bees really do love the flowers and it lasts for a long time. You can actually eat the flowers too on top of your salads or what have you. And they're absolutely delicious and really, really look pretty. So Jerry's pointing out something there. Not too sure what that is, but he's going to the top of the hill. So you might
see. That's where I'm going.
Oh, that's where you're going.
Yes,
okay.
That's where I'm.
So you may see a really good view here in just a moment. And I hope you guys are enjoying the view and celebrating our Earth.
Yeah.
Okay, 808 Ladybug. I noticed the Earth Day events we went to this weekend focused highly on educating children. Woohoo, high five, Kim. Thank you so much, 808. It's definitely something we really, really enjoy doing. How long should we dry pepper seeds before planting from Paradigm Gardening? Really good question there, Paradigm Gardening. What I like to do is sometimes if I have space in my garden, I will just leave some of the peppers on the plant to dry. And I like to pick them. If I have the space, leave them on until they kind of rattle a little bit inside the pepper itself. If you don't have room, pull out a couple of peppers, take the seeds out, let them dry on a piece of parchment paper or a paper plate, but they definitely should be all the way completely dry. You don't want them to be wet in any way, shape, or form. So you just kind of have to keep an eyeball on it and make sure they're completely dry, because if they're damp or moist a little bit, they could mold or mildew once you store them. So do make sure that they're super, super dry. Michelle, great question here. Is there something you do to get a pepper plant to be bushy? Yes, absolutely. It is optional, but what you can do, let me grab a pepper here. I'll grab this little one, is once you plant it in the garden or transplant it, if you like, what you can do, it's called topping it. I forget, I moved my camera on this side this week. What you do is called topping it. So you can go down between, I would wait till it's a little bit bigger maybe, but you can snip off the top 2 to 3 sets of leaves. And what that does, it will push the growth out to the side, so that instead of being super tall, your pepper plant will be bushier. And if you live in a windy area, this might be something you might want to consider doing, or try it with 1 or 2 of your plants and see how it works out. Leave your other plants to grow tall. The disadvantage to this is, though, you are putting off your production a little bit longer, your harvest a little bit longer. Because, like, for example, this one right here is already starting to form, I think, little flowers in the center. So when you cut it off, then it's going to take, you know, a little bit longer to form new flowers and new peppers. So, you know, give it a try. See if it's something that works for you. Or if you were able to start your peppers super early, you may have the time to be able to afford the time to be able to do that. So really good, really good question. Tracy, hi. Which red pepper is the sweetest? Well, I can definitely tell you one of my very favorite ones. And that is the California Wonder Pepper. I've grown it for years. And in fact, one of these plants in my little purple pot, if you watch my pepper biggest and best video, I planted that on that video, is a California Wonder. And I love it. It's bright red. It has nice thick walls, very sweet. And we love to just throw it on the grill and eat it that way, or put it in fresh pico de gallo, which is like a fresh salsa. And by the way, we still do have some of our salsa garden boxes left. That was the March box. So if you want to grow yourself a salsa garden, you can grab that over on our website at CallieKimGardeningHome.com. And I almost forgot, today's the last day. We ran a little flash sale for Earth Day, 50% off all seed collections. So grab those today. They are going very, very quickly. So grab off all 30 of our seed collections, including the pepper seed collection, and you can get 50% off that with the code Happy Earth Day. Okay, camera guy, what a nice view up there. You're getting up pretty high, and I don't know how his connection is going to be, so we'll have to see on that. Looks like he might be buffering just a little bit, but hopefully we'll be okay. So let's jump back into our second tip here. And that is, someone was just asking, when do you plant peppers outdoors? Okay, so my second tip is don't plant them too soon. And I'm going to qualify that in just a moment. But what I found is that when I get the peppers outside, when it's a little bit still in the chilly nights, like maybe 35, 40, even in the 50s, they don't do a whole lot. They just kind of sit there. But once the nights get in the 60s, that is really the ideal time they absolutely love. And you can plant them. They're nice and warm. They just kind of love that warmth. And then they really, really take off. So you can plant them early if you like. But I would really recommend, if it dips down under, I'm going to say even maybe 40s, even definitely when it dips down under 40 degrees, use some kind of protection. A 5-gallon bucket is a super easy thing to just pop over them at night, just to give them that nice little bit of warmth. Cliff Lutt does the wall of waters over his tomatoes and peppers. I know he's always planting things out there early. So definitely, if you're gonna plant them early, do give them some protection, or just manage your expectations that they're not going to grow too much until the nights and the days start to warm up. I planted several plants outside, I want to say 2 to 3 weeks ago, and they really haven't done much at all because our nights are still down in the 40s. We had a couple nights in the 30s that I did cover them. But as soon as they get in the 50s and 60s, they are going to really, really take off. So just, excuse me, keep that in mind. I really do like to wait until they are about this size here. These are about, I want to say, close to 6 inches tall. They've got about 1, 2, 3, 4 sets of leaves on them. And they've been hardening off. These have actually been spending the night outside in my little smart pots. What I typically do is transplant from my six packs, because I usually don't have time to transplant my whole flat of six packs at once. So I transplant three or four plants in the 1 gallons or in the smart pots transplanters, and then just make sure they're all hardened off. And then I'll separate them and plant them out in the garden from here. It usually takes me about a month or so to get everything planted out in the garden. And you're going to be amazed at how much they really take off once the temperatures are warm. Okay, Jerry is out there hiking away. And Jerry, are you at a point where we could do the next giveaway, or should we wait and do one more tip number three first? You ready for another one? He might be a little out of breath, you guys. And, you know, kudos to him because he's carrying his gear in between each little hike. So it's kind of like he's, you know, he's out there.
Go for it. I think I have a good high point. Yeah, do it.
Okay, perfect. Wonderful. All right, guys, we are going to do another Earth Day package giveaway. All right. Again, here's our package here.
Really, stop.
The takedown spray by Mount, or takedown is a concentrate, which you can add to water and make a spray out of it.
Yeah, go and for then the. Yeah, go for the drawing.
Okay, and the Pepper Seed Collection and the Smart Pot. So go ahead and put Earth Day in there if you haven't yet. If you already have put Earth Day in, you don't need to do it again. And this is just for US residents only and just for our live audience. So if you're watching the replay, this is for our live audience. We're doing the giveaway live. So go ahead and pop Earth Day in there.
Good luck,
and,
everybody.
Let me know also, once we get past the drawing, I see lots of comments scrolling by about different varieties of peppers, sweet peppers, hot peppers. And we would love to hear some good recommendations of peppers. And by the way, if you don't win the giveaway, do make sure you check out Monterey's products over on their website, MontereyLawnGarden.com. The discount code is here on the screen. They got lots of good pest control products, disease control products, which work very, very well. And also check out SmartPots.com for tons and tons of different sizes containers, whether it be from fabric raised beds, 10 gallons or 1 gallon, I think, on up to what Smart Pots, 1,000 gallons, which is crazy. So you can plant a lot, anything that you want in Smart Pots as well. Okay, we're going to go ahead and do our drawing here, our second Earth Day package. 58 cool. entries this time. All right, guys. So nice. Here we go. 3, 2, and one. Hit it, Dana. Go ahead and draw.
How exciting. It always slows down at the end.
And our winner is Yay. Patricia Treadway. Woohoo, Patricia, so excited for you. And we've got your contact information. So we will send your winner, your prizes right out to you. I know you're gonna need those there in Southern Arizona, where it gets super, super hot out there, and you're gonna absolutely love it. And we do have a special guest here. Just saw them in the chat. Monterey Lawn Garden is here on our live stream. The pest and disease control experts are here to help us out, answer your questions. And Monterey and Smart Pots both, we really appreciate you helping us out with the giveaway today. And we know we're going to be learning a lot from you. So welcome. We're so glad that you're here. Camera guy, what a beautiful view Monterey behind you there. Go ahead, Jerry.
Yeah, it is. I'm not too sure if I'm breaking up or not, but I'm going to go ahead and go for it. But I wanted to
just wanted to
let you know, too, that Monterey is going to start being in our chats.
That's awesome. So you've got some questions. Go ahead and direct
about
them.
Their products to Monterey.
Exactly. Ask away. And they will be happy to answer any questions you might have, as well as Smart Pots, which does that for us every week. So we really, really appreciate you being here and supporting our gardening effort. So thank you so much.
Hey, Kim, is this a good spot? Can you hear me here?
I can, yeah. It's so pretty behind you.
Okay, let me just tell you about what's behind me real quick, and then I'll move on down the road, okay?
You got it.
Okay.
We can hear you loud and clear.
So these hills that I'm showing you are actually very famous from a television show. Let's see who can guess it in the chat. I can't read the chat, so this will be interesting. But this show is about a family who settled down on a prairie. And small country western family. Kim, see if anybody's guessed it yet in the chat.
Let's see.
He's going to get it.
Not but good guess.
But these are the hills. These are the hills where there was a little house built. And they lived on the prairie.
All right, we got some guesses.
We have some guesses coming in now.
We sure do.
Yes.
Lots of people
So this
guessing.
Is where they... Yep. Anyone guess it yet, Kim?
Oh, yeah. I think about 10 people have guessed it so far correctly.
That's correct. This is where they filmed Little House on the Prairie. Their cabin was, you know, in these hills here. And the old town where they always went into and stuff and ran into that bratty girl in the school and stuff or, you know, behind those foothills as well. So it's just kind of a little neat little history about these mountains here. And they recently had a reunion here. I think a 50-year reunion is what it was. And it was packed. People were just so excited to have some of the actors and actresses there and get a chance to interact with them. So that's the little fabulous moment there, the little history of Hollywood. And now I will just move on down this trail here. You can see my gear. So I'll get ready for our next shot.
Beautiful view, and camera guy is right in there celebrating Earth Day during carrying all of his gear. So thank you so much for showing that to us. It really is a beautiful, beautiful area. High up on a hill, you can see tons of beautiful views. On a clear day, you can see all the way to the ocean. So we really do love doing this hike.
All right, I'll talk to you in a minute.
Okay, we'll talk to you in a minute, camera guy. Thanks for showing that to us. That's true. Love those simpler times, says the Mangiarino Adventures. And I don't know about you, but I grew up on Little House on the Prairie. That was one of the things my parents allowed us to watch because it was a nice, wholesome show along with the Waltons. Those are the two ones that I really remember growing up, and I think a lot of us do too. So it always brings back good memories. Debbie, yes, how fun to see where Little House on the Prairie was filmed. One of my very favorite shows. I couldn't agree with you more. Okay, let's jump back in here and talk about tip number three for planting peppers. And I love this tip because it really does help you be able to grow more beautiful peppers, especially in the hot weather. And that is make sure that you plant your peppers closely together. And you can see here, I actually have this little blue smart pot right behind me here, but you can see here on our pepper video, I planted them maybe two per pot, so maybe about a foot or so apart. And the reason for that is peppers are especially susceptible to something called sun scald. If you've grown peppers for a couple of years, you probably know what this is. But the side of the pepper, the wall of the pepper, it's almost like they get a sunburn. It kind of thins out a little bit. It turns kind of a light brownish color, and it almost becomes translucent. So when you plant them closely together, the pepper leaves themselves kind of shade the pepper fruit as the fruit develop and really do help prevent sun scald. So, and they grow fine, planted closely together, again, about two in a 5-gallon container, and that 15-gallon that was on our giveaway today, you can plant about three, maybe four plants if you push it just a little bit. But the thing with sun scald is it does happen in hot climates. You still can eat, or not eat, but use that pepper. But you do want to get it and harvest it as soon as you see that sun scald patch, because it can really, if it opens up, it can introduce bacteria into the pepper, or bugs can get in there. And all you have to do is just cut that sun scald spot off, and the rest of the pepper is just fine. But why not prevent it as much as you can by planting your peppers fairly close together? And then they just kind of enjoy like touching each other, I found. And they really don't, you plant like two or so in a 5-gallon, especially in a smart pot, they're not really going to be competing for nutrients and water. Again, especially in a smart pot, because of the aerated fabric, they have that nice fibrous root mass, the air prune. So they're not going to get root bound. So they're still going to be able to take up the nutrients, take up the water, and grow very, very nicely for you when you plant them close together. So I want to hear in the chat here if you have tried this and how that's gone with you. If if you planted them closely. Julie, great question here. How many pepper plants under a regular tomato cage? Well, I would say it kind of depends on your the size of your container, if you're planting in containers. And kind of gauge that as far as that goes. If you're planting in raised beds, under a regular tomato cage, I would probably put two. In fact, I planted some this weekend down in our fountain planter, and I have two in a small tomato cage. That's probably pushing the envelope just a little bit. And maybe I'll end up, popping in a big cage. But I'd say two, every foot apart or so, you could space them. And even in our fountain planter down there, it's about 2 feet wide. So I'll put kind of one on one edge, one on the other edge, and then put a little cage around it. And I've grown it that way for years, and it does very, very well. Okay, great. Cliff, good suggestion here. If your tomato cage is wider at the bottom than at the top, then you might want to try two. Definitely try that. Or you can even do a little inverted cage trick, which I like to do with my tomatoes, is where you could kind of flip the cage around and put the wider part at the bottom and the narrower part at the top, because of course they're going to grow up like that, and you might need the wide spot at the bottom to kind of give you a nice, good base for your peppers. Okay, V, good question here. What size of a smart pot would a cucumber be okay? I like to plant my cucumbers in 5-gallon containers. Make sure you watch our cucumber video, V. I planted one at each base of my trellis there in the 5-gallon. I put a little bamboo trellis in, and I've grown 3 in a 5-gallon for years, and it works really, really well. Of course, if you go up in containers, you can always plant more. I wouldn't plant one in any smaller of a container, at least a full-size cucumber plant, than a 5-gallon. I think a 1-gallon would be just a little bit too small for that, because of course, the bigger your container, the more production you're going to have. So the roots will have more room to spread out, to grow, and to thrive. Kim, great feedback here. I do plant them close together every year. If you do the square foot gardening style, you can plant 2 to 3 plants per square foot. So great, great suggestion there, Kim, on planting intensively and using the square foot gardening method. In fact, I have a whole intensive planting chart in my book on raised bed gardening, as well as a succession planting chart at the very end. So if you want a little guide for that, grab my book on raised bed gardening and you'll have all the info and the resources that you need for that. Okay, let me jump into our next tip here. Let me turn my page here. It's getting a little bit breezy, so my notes are kind of blowing away here. If you do live in a climate where it maybe doesn't get that hot, I meant to mention this at the beginning, where it doesn't get that hot, or you have a short growing season, you may want to try planting some smaller varieties of peppers, a little bit more compact varieties, maybe peppers that aren't so huge and massive, so that you can make sure that you get a harvest before the weather gets too cold. Or you could pop up a little greenhouse. There's lots of little portable greenhouses out there you could pick up. Or if you're really get ambitious, you can get one of those greenhouse kits and build like a stand-up greenhouse. I know my sister lives up in Oregon right on the coast, and they rarely get above 70 degrees in the summertime. Some summers hotter than others, but she's got a beautiful little greenhouse where she grows her tomatoes, peppers, cucumbers, and she used to never be able to grow any of those warm weather vegetables without a greenhouse. So something to consider if you're getting a little bit deeper into gardening is get a little greenhouse and grow your peppers and your other vegetables that are warm weather lovers in a greenhouse. So just a little suggestion. Okay, Veronica Baines just got a bunch of 2-gallon buckets from my local bakery. Are there varieties that you recommend for buckets this small? 2-gallon buckets, that would be about double this size. The Cubanelles tend to be a little bit smaller. I would just look and see for varieties that, like the California Wonder is a pretty good size solid pepper. So I would just maybe Google it and look for smaller varieties of peppers. And I'm sure some will pop right up. There's also some little mini bell peppers. I grew some of those last year, and they're probably maybe an inch or two across and wide. Those would be nice little ones. But I definitely for that, I would only plant one plant per 2-gallon. Okay, tip number 4 for peppers is consistent watering and feeding. And I feel like this is super important, especially for peppers, because they do have pretty shallow roots. They're not like tomatoes that have a really extensive, deep, deep root system. Their roots are very shallow. So if, especially in containers, if you let your containers completely dry out, they can get a little bit, a little bit dry during waterings, but do not let them get completely dry because of their roots being shallow. They're not going to do well. What happens when your container completely dries out and you let it dry out is that your plant gets stunted. It's looking for the water. It's not finding the water. It's not finding the resource that it needs. And so it just kind of stalls out, stops growing, and goes into stress mode. And a plant that's stressed is not going to do well. And once your containers dry out, it's really hard to get them hydrated again. A couple times last summer, my drip, either the battery ran out or it somehow got shut off. And all of a sudden I noticed all my container plants were drooping. And then once I turned my irrigation on, the water just kind of ran through it. It didn't absorb into the soil. So I had to work really hard to get all of my plants rehydrated again by mixing the moisture into the soil, either manually or putting them in a little bin so they could soak up and get resaturated again. So definitely stay consistent with your watering. Do yourself a favor. If you're on drip irrigation, when the weather starts to heat up, make sure that you check your frequency. You may have to water your containers definitely more frequently than your in-ground garden, but the smaller the container, the more frequent it's going to need to be watering. So my plan this summer, especially for my hanging baskets, is to put them on a separate system where they get watered twice a day, because in 90 to 100 degree temperatures, once a day just isn't enough and they start to dry out. So do make sure you pay attention to the frequency of your drip. If you don't have drip, just make sure you can be consistent with watering either from your nozzle or with your watering can. And again, I mentioned one way that's a really effective way to water your containers is to just set them in a bin of water. Let them soak up, completely hydrate, and then take them out of the bin. And you'll be having to do a lot less manual watering with your hose that way. And another tip, along with consistent watering, is consistent feeding. Make sure that you feed them your containers every 2 weeks. If you watch our pepper video, you saw how I watered it at the time of planting with Monterey's Epsom salts. And this works really well with all plants, but especially peppers. At time of planting, watering them with the Epsom salt in a watering can really just helps that vibrant, green, lush growth. Has magnesium in it, which really kickstarts the production of chlorophyll. And then once they start to flower, give them another dose of that Monterey Epsom salts, and it really will help them kick into fruit production mode. So make a little note on your calendar. When you plant them and water them and feed them with Epsom salts, and I always use the Vermicera Vitality as well, and then about a month later, put that Epsom salt in your watering can again. About a month or when they start to flower, and you'll be amazed at how many more peppers that you can grow that way. Okay, so let's jump back into the chat here, answer some of the questions before we move on to the next tip. And we do have another surprise at the end, so don't go away. It's going to be a good one as well. And Monterey, yes, we got to love those Epsom salts. They're so easy to use, and you can find those over at MontereyLawnGarden.com. Again, you can use the code CALLIKIM10 to get 10% off their site-wide. And I think someone else was asking where to buy Smart Pots, and those can be found over at SmartPots.com. The code over there for 10% off is CALLIKIM, all sizes, shapes, colors, and we also have the CALLIKIM branded pots over on our website, CALLIKIMGardeningHome.com, as well as 30 different seed collections and my books and all kinds of fun stuff, the subscription boxes, and it's all over there for you. Okay, let's see. Let's scroll through here and see what other questions we might have going on here in the chat. And Anne Boland here. Thank you so much, Anne. Great to see you on our live stream today. When you put the plant in a bin of water, do you wait until the top of the soil is moist, or how do you know how you have enough water? Very good question, Anne. What I like to do is I put it in my bin and I fill it, my bin, maybe half the way up. And then I look for the top of the soil of the container. Typically when I put it in, it's dry. So the top of the soil will be a light brown color. Right now, these are just watered yesterday in my bin right over here. So they're a dark brown color, which indicates that there's moisture. So once the top of the soil turns dark brown, or when you pick the pot up, you're going to notice it's a lot heavier. than when you put it in, which indicates, you know, it's got some moisture content in there. At that point, take them out of the bin, pour the water off. I always pour my extra water usually into my hanging baskets. If I'm fertilizing it, I've got some worm tea in there, then that all goes in my hanging baskets as well. And your plant is nice and watered and saturated, and you won't have to water it near as often. So great question there. And thank you so much. Tomatoes and poetry. If it's in a pot, pick it up. If it's heavy, don't need water until it's light. So yeah, great suggestion there. You're gonna kind of get to know your plants, right? Depending on the container that they're in, the size container that they're in, whether they're in a little six pack like this one, you'll get to know them. As you pick them up, you'll realize, okay, it's light, that means it needs watered, or it's heavy, that means we're good to go. So it's just a little bit of trial and error, but as the longer that you garden, you're gonna get a lot better at it as well. And Wickershire Project Off, this is a great suggestion too. I love this. And I try and mulch whenever I can. Mulching retains water. Always mulch pots or beds. Never let them dry out. You stress the plants with dry, wet cycles and loosen beneficial microbes if it dries too much. Absolutely. I love how you put that. It definitely does stress the plants. So if you're going dry, wet, the plant's not gonna know what to do, and it's not gonna grow as well. And of course, the beneficial microbes can also die as well. So do keep your plants evenly moist. I always like to say consistent watering really is the key to a productive garden. So if there's anything that you can do, it's water consistently. I really encourage you to do that. If you can install drip irrigation, all that much better, right? I know some places, if you live on a deck, you know, an apartment, you might not have access to a hose bib. You might not be able to do that. But if at all possible, install drip in your containers and keep them on a separate timer too. They definitely need watering more often than your raised beds or your in-ground garden. Okay, we are gonna do one more tip, and then we have a surprise at the end, okay? And tip number five is support your peppers with a tomato cage or a stake. Now, typically tomato cages that you buy at the garden center are not big enough for tomatoes, unless you're using a couple different layers or levels of tomato cages. But typically a small tomato cage or a regular sized tomato cage works absolutely beautifully for peppers. If you've been gardening for a long time, you probably have stacks of them in the corner of your garden, just like I do, and they're great for peppers. So pull them out, pop them over your pepper plants. A lot of people say you don't need a stake for peppers, but I always stake my peppers, and here's why. The stems tend to be pretty delicate, and especially when they're loaded down with peppers, because we're going to be growing a lot of peppers on our plants. Since we're taking care of them so well, we're doing it right, and they do need stakes, because the leaves or the branches can just break right off, the plant will flop over. It's just not going to be as productive as if you have it in a cage. And I really prefer a cage over a stake, because you can definitely use a stake if you want to, but the cage, you really don't have to do anything. The pepper just grows up the cage. The stake, you always have to be tying the stem to the stake to keep it upright. And what I find is I just forget to do it. I don't have time to do it. I like to make it as easy on myself and automate as many things as possible, because chances are I'm going to forget, my pepper's going to flop over, and then I've lost my chance, or the stem might break. I've lost my chance for the season with my plant. So a small tomato cage is generally adequate for a couple of peppers, and you'll be amazed at the difference that can make in your pepper production. It always gets a little bit, you know, when you first plant your plants, they look so small, and I don't like the look of wire cages when my plants are tiny. So I can never wait for them to grow in, kind of hide the cage and be invisible. But it really, really will help. And I know you're going to thank me later in the season when you have your cages installed on your pepper plants and have lots and lots of support for them. So definitely make sure you do that. Those small tomato cages are very inexpensive. And I always have a stash of them around my yard or my garden, but use whatever you've got. I've even made little cages out of sticks, small bamboo arches, and wound twine around them. Go back and watch our trellis video we posted a couple of weeks ago for all different kinds of trellises. And if you want some different types, that'll probably give you some good ideas. Okay, let's see. We're going to do one more question before we do our very last giveaway of the live stream. It's going to be a fun one. Let's see, Ramona Jolly, I like to try paprika peppers to make my own paprika. That's a great, great idea. I've always wanted to try those. This year, new to our tomato seed collection, I think it's either in this one or a salsa seed collection, is the pepperoncini peppers. I'm not sure if I said that correctly, but that's one of my favorite peppers because it's a little bit spicy, but not too spicy. And you can eat them raw and they're not too hot. There's lots of different peppers you can try. I've got a couple pepperoncinis growing over here. They're just doing beautifully. I think we've got purple peppers in here, California Wonders, the pepperoncinis, the jalapeno, and maybe one more sweet one, which the name escapes me, but definitely grab the pepper seed collection, and it's not too late to get them started from seed. Okay, one more question here. Pepperoncini, yeah, absolutely delicious. Trey, I struggle with getting full-size bell peppers. Any tips? I would definitely recommend you make sure you're very consistent with your fertilizing schedule. And I talk about that in our pepper video. You can go back and check that out. I do have my full season fertilizing schedule in my raised bed gardening book. Definitely pick that up. It's a great resource. I recommend containers every 2 weeks, raised beds about once a month, the mid-season boost, and also an end of season boost at the very end of the season to kick in your pepper production. The Epsom salts by Monterey helps a ton with flowering. So definitely make sure you're boosting the flower production to boost your pepper production. And also one last little tip, I know our live stream is going long today. One last little tip is when it gets over 95 degrees, make sure you cover your peppers with shade cloth because the blossoms will dry out if they get too hot. Once the blossoms dry out, you're starting over. So do make sure you keep that shade cloth handy so you can grow lots of peppers yet this season here. And we're just going to grow the rainbow. We're bringing you along as we're harvesting, and for any other pepper tips as well, we'll definitely bring you the resources that you need to grow lots of peppers. Okay, Jerry, we're going to check in with him out in the field there. How's things going up there on the trail? Oh, he's getting hot here, I can tell, right? Took off the hiking shirt, got the t-shirt on. How's it going there?
Oh, it definitely got warm here, but it's thoroughly been a blast. Doing the hike with you all, taking you around, especially on this day, and especially that we all like to grow our own food organically. There's nothing better than that, than tasting the food that you grow and sharing with others. So thanks for everyone for hanging out with us today. I'm at the end of the trail.
We've got one more special surprise though, Jerry.
Oh.
Don't leave yet.
Okay.
We've got one more special surprise. A giveaway. One more giveaway.
That's right.
And this is a special Earth Day something, and this I highly encourage everyone to do this to celebrate Earth Day, and that is composting. I don't think there's any better way you could celebrate by either adding to your compost pile or start a compost pile. And one lucky winner is going to be able to start one with a Smart Pots urban compost sack. I love my urban compost sack. I've been composting it for a couple of years. It keeps everything contained. It's a little bit smaller than the big giant compost sack by Smart Pots. It's 50 gallons, which is perfect for a patio or a balcony. It can fit in the corner of our deck here. Absolutely love it. And I can make finished compost from start to finish in about a month. So definitely want to check out our compost, whole compost playlist, but especially making compost in a small space. So put in the comments again, the same hashtag Earth Day to enter in for our Smart Pots urban compost sack. And one lucky winner is going to be getting one to start composting on their own. And you know, I add to my urban compost sack probably every single week. Got a nice finished one and then one that is continually in process, and it's got a cover to keep the critters out. And it really is handy for composting. Really anyone can start composting in the compost sack. It's a great way to celebrate our earth. Less goes to the landfill, and we make good use of turning trash into beautiful fertilizer, black gold fertilizer for our garden. So it's really a great way to celebrate our earth together here too. I know a lot of you are already doing it, but lots of Earth Day hashtags. And it's one of my very favorite things to do. Look at that beautiful black gold there in the compost sack. And I love the green color too. It's really fun. Okay, let's see here. We have got, whoa, 61 entries. This is
wow,
a popular
that's fabulous.
One, right? So
yes.
Smart Pots, thank you so much for making this available to us today.
Yes, good play Smart Pots and good play Monterey and Cali Kim for all the donations for the prizes today. What a blast. That's awesome.
Absolutely. So much fun. Okay, we're going to go ahead and draw 65 people here in this giveaway. So Dana, 3, 2, 1, here we go.
Come on. Who's it going to be?
Crossed.
Kim.
Our winner is Roxanne Tracy. Roxanne, congratulations. Really excited for you to start composting in the Smart Pots compost sack. So Roxanne, if you could please email me, CalliKim@CalliKimGardeningHome.com, all your contact, your mailing information, and I'll get that to Smart Pots and they'll send that right out to you. So congratulations. Super excited for you to start composting.
Nice
okay,
job.
Jerry, are you ready to start hiking back?
Yeah, I am.
Tired?
No, it was good.
Yeah, this is great. You guys, thanks so much for hanging out here with us today on our special Earth Day live stream. Thanks for celebrating. Do make sure, Jerry's got his water. Make sure you join us again next Monday at noon Pacific time. And do watch our videos. We post videos every Wednesday and every Saturday. And if you're missing those, you are missing out because we're giving you the resources that you need to grow your garden, be successful, and grow lots of veggies and save money at the grocery store at the same time. So we want to thank Monterey Lawn and Garden and Smart Pots for helping us out with the giveaways, for being here in the chat. Really appreciate all the resources you're sharing with us. And thanks to you all for taking the time to be here today. Happy Earth Day. Go out and plant something and celebrate for the rest of the day.
And one thing you all could do that could really help us is if you do watch our videos, click the like button. That, believe it or not, that is very powerful in the YouTube world, and that does help us. So if you would like to, that would be fabulous. Thank you. We'd be indebted to you.
Definitely. And if you haven't subscribed, make sure you subscribe as well. So we'll see you on YouTube, and we'll see you on next Monday's live stream. Take
Bye,
care,
everyone.
Y'all.
Thanks, Bye-bye. Dana.